Hello and welcome to the Sankofa podcast. As promised, I'll be sitting down with representatives from all the various political parties because this one is such an important year in terms of our politics. Today, we are graced by the presence of a vibrant young man from the UDF, United Democratic Front, Mr. Mabasen Narib. Sir, welcome to the Sankofa podcast. Please introduce yourself to my guests, to my audience.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lolo, and thanks for having me here. Good morning to the viewers.
Yes,
my name is basically Mabasen Narib. I'm the national spokesperson of UDF Party. UDF Party is a party that comes backdated from pre-independence era. So it's not a party that has started today. We have been around on the political landscape of Namibia for quite some time. But now we are in a transitional and transformation phase of the party to make it a full-fledged political organization that should champion all the interests of Namibians, all Namibians, irrespective of their race, irrespective of their ethnicity, irrespective of their religious beliefs. And that should happen under the banner of UDF. So that's what we represent.
Great. Good to hear. This man just wants to run. Okay. Tell us about, you know, the transition or the perceived transition from the Damara Rad to the UDF. Is it the Damara Rad that formed the UDF or what happened there exactly?
Okay, Damara Rad was not a political movement. Damara Rad was basically, it's on the similar footing as ODA or any traditional authority.
Okay.
They were governing, like, you know, during the time of apartheid, there was, Namibia was divided into homelands. And every homeland was supposed to be governed by their native administrators. So Damara Rad was governing Damara land, if like you know that side of Korihas, down from Kaogo. So Damara Rad was responsible for native administration of the Damaras. Now, the election period came and Damaras also wanted to be represented, for example.
All right.
But then it was said they cannot do it from a political, from a traditional authority.
I see.
So Damara Rad ended there. So when UDF was formed, the reason why it's perceived that it is a Damara movement is because King Justice Karoep, who is the Damara, the paramount king of Damaras, was the founding president of UDF.
Of UDF.
So naturally, that created that perception to say that, no, this must be the party for the Damaras.
I see.
But if you look at the formation of UDF, it is actually the name itself tells you the story of how it was founded. It's a United Democratic Front. It's a formation of various fronts that came together to form an alliance to make one political party. A smaller party such as Original People's Party of Theopeles Soresep. You had Dirhat there from Labour Party. You had Seseseo, who was from the Caprivi Alliance. You had KANU PF, also from Caprivi. So these parties came together and then they were like, what should we call this alliance? And they said, we are united, we are democratic, and we are various fronts which came together. That's where the name UDF originated from. UDF is not a transition from Damara Rad to a political party. But it's just that Damaras also wanted to be part of the political process. And they decided, okay, let's see what we can do. And at the forefront of those talks was the king. So the king joined politics. And naturally, if you are a king, obviously you'll be followed by people that you are leading. So that's why the whole perception was created that UDF is a
Damara party.
But no, it's not a Damara party.
Great. No, it's actually good that you clear that one.
Yes.
Because there is popular perception that UDF is a predominantly Damara party. And if one looks at your strongholds, being Kunene, where you find predominantly Damara-speaking people, and then the Irongo region, Downres, where UDF was like championing all these years. It's predominantly Damara areas. So that merger did actually not translate into UDF being all over Namibia.
What happened was in the beginning, UDF was all over.
Okay.
But these little fronts which formed the bigger UDF started to break away. You had people like Dirkhat who later joined SWAPO. You had other fronts that withdraw from UDF. And all that was left now was King Justice Karoo. And being a king, obviously his strongholds will be in areas where he's popular or where he has people that are following him. So he maintained his support in those areas. So now come 2013, it was now up to the leadership that took over from King Justice Karoo. They were supposed to transform the party into a political movement that will be all over the whole country, that will be represented in all areas of the country. But this thing, it happened slowly. There were some seeds that were planted in Rundu. There are some branch. There's a branch in Rundu, for example. They were also present at the National Congress in January. They also sent delegates to the Youth League Congress. Okay. There are also some seeds that were planted in Kabrivi. But major impact was not really done in terms of making the movement to be felt, its presence to be felt nationally. So coming back to say that, why is it that only UDF is having its strongholds in predominantly Damara areas? If you have to see mobilization in terms of apartheid era, you had to start in your area where you are based, because you needed the pass to travel. Your traveling was restricted. So even in natural sense, if you cannot convince your own to follow you, who will you able to convince to follow you? So that, I think that's the analogy that worked for UDF all this while. But even in Kunene itself, it's not just Damaras that are there. We have got Herero speaking people. Because if you take a constituency like Sesfontein, if you rely on Damara votes alone, you will not be able to win it, because there are places like Omuramba, there are places like Ongunda or Chokavare. Those are predominantly Herero areas, which falls under Sesfontein constituency. The reason why we have been winning that constituency over and over again is because we also have Herero speaking people there in those areas. So the thing is just that the transition has been happening at a very slow pace.
Okay, now in terms of, we are aware that even if you as a political party has got some serious presence in a given area, still the people behind the budgets and the coffers of the country, and they have got the means of development, are still with the ruling party. How easy is it actually to rule in such an environment?
It's very difficult. Because the political setup of Namibia is not friendly for an opposition party. Like, even if you're governing a specific constituency or a region, the majority, like the setup of the governance of Namibia, is that everything flows from the center. Let's say, for example, you have to build a clinic in your constituency. The tender is allocated from Windhoek, from the center, from central government. Supervision is done from central government. You don't necessarily have any say or any control over what happens, because all these things are national projects. It's just sort of like to say you are voting for representation, so that you will be represented, to know what's happening, and so that your voice can also be heard. But this person that you are voting in will be outnumbered when it comes to regional councils, when it comes to National Assembly, because they do not have the two-third majority to amend these laws. Because everything that happens, actually, there is a legal framework that enables that act to take place. So it's very difficult to operate in such a space, because the power of governance is seated in the center. So that is the problem. That's where the problem comes from.
How has the transition been? If you can just share with us, you know.
The past 4 months after the Congress, the party is showing that it's becoming a vibrant movement. The party is more in the media now. Like, for example, myself, I'm also in the media a lot. Like, we engage. We have also accepted the invitation to come to this podcast. That shows that, like, we are moving in the right direction. And in terms of how the vision that the current president has, it's to make the party a national party. And they have been to Kidmans, they have started a branch there. They have been to Rehoboth as well. They have started a branch there. And there are members there of UDF. And we are just not focusing on those traditional strongholds that we previously spoke about. But now we want to move into all areas. UDF is there. We have got long years of existence, but now we want to show you that we have passed the test of time, but now we want to show you that we are a political formation that belongs to all Namibians, and that everybody should feel free to join the party, and that nobody will be denied membership based on their ethnicity or their sexual beliefs or whatever, and that UDF really has that vision of making it a political formation that will champion all the interests of young people, old people, all Namibians under the banner of UDF. That's what
okay. Now, because you touched on a subject that's very much on my heart, when you talk about, you know, uniting all Namibians, you know, under this one, this movement and what. So I'm a very nationalistic person, you know. I believe that, you know, in Namibia, for us to have a beautiful life or the life that we want to live peacefully, we need to realize that we are first Namibians.
Yes.
Before you are even your tribe.
Yes.
You know, you are first a Namibian before your gender or whatever. So that sort of patriotism, that sort of nationhood is what I long for. Now, if with UDF, let's say you get more power, you know, power's influence. How will you get to the realization of that nationhood? What are you going to do differently? That will, because you know, and you should agree that Namibians are tribally based. We are very tribal people. Even if we don't want to admit it, we are tribally. That's why we even vote along tribal lines, you know. So we are very tribally loyal. What are you going to do to break that and to make us, you know, realize that we are Namibians actually? And then you are a Damara or a Ovaer or a Colored or whatever. So how are you going to bring us together?
Okay, in terms of uniting the Namibian nation, it has to start with the government's attitude towards when it comes to redistribution of the resources of the country. The government, just because our party has predominantly more Damaras, that should not tell us that we must take all the resources to areas where there are Damaras. When opportunities are available, economic opportunities, education opportunities, we must have that thing of tolerance and the ability to accommodate all Namibians. And opportunities should not be awarded along tribal lines. And Namibians should forget about this thing. Like, there should be education to be given to the people to tell them that, look, we are busy with building a nation. We are Namibians first, like you were saying. And after that, we can resort back to our tribes. But resorting back to our tribes should not be to create that division again, or to create a reason for us to align with each other against another Namibian. We should view them to say that, no, this is a Namibian. If they have got the capability to contribute towards nation building or towards economic growth of the country, he or she should be afforded that opportunity to do so. And it should not be a thing of, I must not give you opportunity because I know, okay, you are Nama and Namas and Damaras are like close. I should not think of alliance in terms of tribes, but it should be a thing to say that, who is the best possible person? Is this person a Namibian? That's where we should stop. And we must stop this thing of spreading hate towards tribes like this. Sometimes when kids are growing up, we're telling our kids, no, don't play with the Nama. They like to do this and that. Don't play with the Damara. They like to do this and that. Even like us young men, sometimes our parents tell you, don't intermarry into that tribe. They are like this. Those things, you are actually laying a foundation that will later come up and divide the nation. Because you are teaching this person to say that, no, your tribe is the only better one. Your tribe is the only tribe that has got the capability to do this and that. So we must do away with that thing to say that Namibia is one. And all of us who live in Namibia should hold hands together. And we should build this nation for ourselves and for our future generations.
Okay. Now, you know, this it actually starts with corruption and greed. And that's where it plays down towards looking into your tribal, you know, advancing people from your tribe. How will UDF approach the corruption in Namibia? What is UDF's stance on the corruption in Namibia?
It's policy standpoint on corruption. It's that
policy level, yes.
Yes, we believe that ACC the Anti-Corruption Commission should be enabled to handle and deal with culprits that are found to be having corrupt dealings, and that they should not be covering for people that are corrupt. And the justice system has to be independent, so that whoever that is found with corrupt dealings should be punished for what they have done. Mm. And there should not be no room to say that, no, he's our comrade, let's cover for him. Mm. And there has to be level of accountability and transparency. Because if you have that culture of transparency, then there is little room for corruption. Mm. Where people are not informed, where the nation is not informed, that's where people get the room to steal. That's where people get the room to do away with corruption, because these things are not in public knowledge. So when deals and things are done behind closed doors, that's where corruption breeds more. And the other thing also has to be that we must have this approach of the procurement system. There has to be a lot of amendments done around the procurement system of Namibia.
Okay.
Because that's where, through awarding of tenders, that's where a lot of corruption is also taking place. Because tenders have been inflated. Tenders are given to comrades that are linked to political parties so that they can do kickbacks to political parties. And we don't have this approach of saying that we are actually damaging the nation itself, that we are denying Namibians resources and opportunities that they could have gotten to make this nation, first of all, a better country for all of us. Because we are just looking at it from, how can we give this tender to this person so that they can do kickbacks to this party so that we can remain in power? That should not be the approach. Once you are given the opportunity to govern, you must come in and you must address the issues that are on the ground level through your governance, because politics determines who gets what and when that resource will be available to that person. So in terms of like UDF coming into the power, we must look at how we are going to bring our philosophy of social democracy into place. That's where we say that we must have a regulated capitalistic system where poorest of the poor should also be brought up, and inequalities should be addressed through social welfare programs. So if in doing these things, there should be no room for us to be corrupt, because if you have to have a program where you want to address inequalities and you still stand with corruption, you will never be able to do that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, because it's like resources that are ending up in wrong hands. So there has to be strict measures of control. There has to be transparency. There has to be accountability. Those are the only ways how you can get rid of corruption. As long as you are not accountable, even if it's $1, even if it's a donation that you get, the nation must know that you got this donation, and the nation must know how that donation was utilized. So that's the only way that you will be able to get rid of corruption.
Do we see that kind of transparency within the internal affairs of UDF?
After we have taken over power, we, at the Central Committee that took place in Ochewarongo on the 19th, financial statements were presented to the Central Committee. In terms of the Constitution, that's the level where we give financial reporting. And the President made the request at the Central Committee, which is the highest decision-making body, to enable the party internal laws to allow the financial reports to be given up to the branch level. So that shows you that if we are accountable for every little cent or penny that the body gets, if we have that culture, we should carry it over if eventually we become the governing party of this country. So it's that small. If you cannot account for a dollar, you will not be able to account for a million. So that's the approach that our president is taking, because his campaign manifesto was deeply rooted into transparency, putting in mechanisms of transparency, accountability. Those were his core values that he brought. And because he's the president now, we believe that's what our party members want from the leadership. So that's the direction that we take as the party. So,
I see. Tell me, in the areas of your current strongholds, like Kunene, some parts of Irongo, these areas are mineral-rich areas. And there have been concerns from the locals that, you know, people are coming in, lithium is tracked out, and you just see people getting mining licenses behind from the chiefs or from in dubious ways, you know. And then what from the party side, because these are your people, you know, what efforts do you put in place, or what do you do to sort of enforce local participation in terms of these mining activities?
Look, this is the policy standpoint of UDF when it comes to mining. We believe that all the mining deals should be renegotiated.
Okay.
We believe that 10%, like for example, they are in some mines that the Namibian nation owns only 10%.
Like Sankofa.
Yes, that should be renegotiated.
Okay.
We believe that locals should be the first people to benefit in terms of unskilled job, for example, semi-skilled job. Those should be the first people that should be given the priority to be absorbed. If a mine opens, for example, that tin mine that opened in Uis, locals should be given the priority when it comes to employment.
But has UDF been instrumental in to that effect today?
Has UDF been instrumental? Mm. We have given this consent over to our MPs so that they raise these points in Parliament as well. One of our MPs, Mr. Apius Ohab, in Parliament as well. One of our MPs, Mr. Apius Ohab, the former president, also held town hall meetings with locals to hear their concerns in Uis as well. So what we are doing is we also, through our regional constituency councillor that is there, we are putting in efforts to raise these concerns.
Mm.
And they have also had meetings, series of meetings with the Minister of Mines and Energy.
Mm.
So I just don't know how far the progress is on that matter. But the general concern that is there is off. It's a national concern, and it just does not concern the locals of Tongres per se.
Mm.
Because like if you have to look at it in terms of like, it's just not the locals that are like, denied the opportunity to benefit from it. It's also the nation, for example. If the lithium has just been exported like that, and we don't own a large stake in that lithium that is taken over, taken out of the country. Secondly, how much percentage are we taxing that mining company that is operating there? Because tax is one of the major revenue boosters of the country.
Absolutely.
So if we can, let's say, for example, get a big chunk of tax from that company, we can use that money and redirect it towards welfare programs. We can redirect it towards helping people to get loans, for example, or grants to start up agricultural projects there in Tongres.
Mm.
We can help them to build dignified houses there in Tongres. We can help them to get, for example, land here in urban areas that can be serviced and low-costing houses can be built for low-income earners. So it's just not a Tongres problem. It's a national problem.
Yeah.
So what Namibia has to do is the legal framework that enables the operations of mines really has to be reviewed and it has to be looked at so that our country should stand a good chance to benefit from our natural resources. Currently, it seems like we are throwing away our natural resources. How can you just own 10% stake in uranium? And until when do we want to just export raw materials? When are we going to start to process and to sell our raw materials as finished products at a higher price? That should also boost the revenue generation of our economy. So all these questions, that's why we are saying our policy standpoint is that we really have to holistically look at the mining sector, and not just the mining sector, also the fishery sector as well, so that we will be able to get benefits, reap benefits from these industries and redirect and redistribute these benefits that will, in a manner that will directly affect the lifestyles and the livelihoods of the Namibians.
I see.
So like we have a people-centered approach on that. And really, as a spokesperson, what we also will do is we'll engage the minister and to find out how the process of awarding EPLs and things are going. Because currently, right now, there's also uprising in the traditional authority there in Tongres.
Yes.
Because people are not happy with the way how chiefs are awarding EPLs.
Mm.
And we cannot leave awarding of EPLs, such a serious matter, into the hands of a local chief.
Mm.
So government can really not just leave such a thing into the hands of local chiefs. There has to be strong control measures. The problem in Namibia is that...
But then don't you think, given the level of corruption within government itself, is it not better perhaps that the locals handle that?
The thing is, okay, it's better if it works in a manner that it's supposed to work.
But it
does not work in the manner that it's supposed to work. Look, chiefs are supposed to be custodians of the land and the natural resources of that specific community.
Absolutely.
But now there are allegations that chiefs themselves are busy with the scheme of enriching themselves and awarding dubious EPLs and things of that nature. So there should be some form of control. In as much as the power is given to the chief, there must be some control to see whether what the chiefs are doing is handled correctly.
Accountability.
Yeah, there should be that aspect of accountability and transparency. And if EPLs, if a company comes to apply for EPL, The chief must also be transparent enough to call in this, the people that he is leading to say that, look, this company wants to get this EPL to do so and so and so. Because people are only seeing once the trucks are arriving. And mind you, some of these areas that are given by chiefs away are areas where people are using for grazing. And it's of a big concern. Because now some people are only surviving from sustainable farming, that little farming that they are doing.
Yeah.
Now, trucks are coming in, destroying the road, destroying the grazing area of the goats. This person does not even benefit anything from that natural resource, but his livelihood is being taken away from him again.
Absolutely.
So it's really not a nice situation.
I get you. That one While we see. Are at natural resources, let's talk about oil. Is it also UDF's view that the oil is not ours?
No. No, the oil is ours. It's found in our backyard. So how can it not be ours?
Okay.
So that's why we are saying there is serious renegotiating that needs to be done in Namibia in terms of natural resources. Because just because somebody is bringing in capital and the know-how does not mean that you should sell 90% of the stake to that person. So we believe that, look, there should be a better way. Let's go into partial ownership. We say 50% should be for the state. 50% can be for the investors that are coming in with their know-how and all that. Because we can get 50% because we are coming with the resource. Without the resource, there is no oil that can be sold. So we are coming in with the most important resource at the end of the day. So we should be able to own that 50% stake to say that, okay, our part is just to get the money that we get and to fund our social welfare programs that should uplift the livelihoods of Namibians. Because the aim of the government should be, how do I address problems that Namibians are having through every revenue that I'm generating, through every sector, every area of mining, every natural resource? So we believe that oil belongs to Namibia and there should be renegotiating done, and it should be partially owned by the Namibian state. There should be a 50-50 deal that should take place. That's our take on the oil. Otherwise,
green hydrogen
for me,
what do you think about the green hydrogen, shall we say, story, or shall we say this whole hype of activity that we hear of this green hydrogen thing? How much truth is in this whole green hydrogen thing? Okay, we see pilot projects popping up, but there is also widespread doubt in terms of, you know, the legitimacy, shall we say, or the reality behind this whole green hydrogen thing. How has UDF assessed this, and what's your stance, and what do you say about this green hydrogen thing?
Just like it's like as if you have just grabbed what's out of my mouth.
Okay.
Like, we don't really have a problem with the concept of green hydrogen, but implementation of this project is already worrisome.
Okay.
For example, you get scholarships that were awarded. You check the list of people that were awarded these scholarships. None of the indigenous people from Dongres, for example, for Dongres green hydrogen project, managed to get the scholarship. So that's already worrisome. And the pace at which this thing is being implemented, the hype is there, but the pace is not matching up with the hype. So that's the problem that I personally have, because the party has not yet made its stand on the whole green hydrogen thing. But like, I will just give you my personal opinion on that one. Our former president met with the former president of the state, the late president of the state. They discussed things there. Unfortunately, as new leadership, we still have to resolve on this issue and to communicate a clear policy standpoint of the party with regards to what is our stance on the green hydrogen project that has been implemented. Because matters like that, they require central committee input, because like in our party, we take all decisions through the central committee. But my personal stance is that it's really a worrisome thing. It's overhyped, but it's not delivering in terms of what has been done on the ground.
I see. Yes, sir. Okay, back to the elections. Why should we vote for you there, actually? Like, let me say I'm a newcomer into voting space. I've just
just turned 18. The voting age, is that the voting age?
Yeah, 18.
Okay. Now, why should I pass all the other parties and go for UDF?
Because UDF is the best alternative out there.
Everybody says that.
No, everybody says that, but they cannot prove why they say they are the best alternative. Okay. The reason why I'm saying we are the best alternative is because I just told you that we have an approach called social democracy, where we have regulated capitalism in terms of using what comes out from the business and natural resources to redirect it to address social programs through social welfare. For example, let me give you a classical example. What we can do is housing. How would address housing under UDF government is that you, in Swakop, let's say you sell a plot in Kramenstor or in Veneta, we'll take 50% of the proceeds of that sale. We'll develop a plot of land there in TRC so that we can also address the informal settlements at the same time. Under UDF government, there will be no room for profit maximization. Okay. And because we also have to look at people that want to better their lives, but they depend on the state to do that. So state should be in a position to address that position, that kind of problems that arise. For example, our standpoint on land is that it should be under the custodianship of the state. We will allow, of course, private ownership of land,
okay,
but land that is there should be serviced and should be allocated to Namibians. And we will award people grants and loans by means of like the example that I just gave you, selling private land to those that have the means to buy it and to build houses. But this building will not be through tenders. We will utilize artisans, qualified artisans that have studied that name, the VTC. These ones, they will be on the payroll of the government so that we cut out the middleman that comes in and inflates the prices. Because a house that can be built for 100,000 through a tender, it becomes 400,000. So from that money, we can easily build four houses. So our economic policies also, for example, will be very different. We have got economic policies that will address the issue of the money that we get back from tax. Like I was saying previously, tax will be increased on mining companies, companies that deal in fisheries, so that we will be able to generate as much as possible as the government and utilize those funds to address the social problems that are there. Other classical example that we also think about this, we don't want to nationalize the banking sector, but we also want to have the legal framework to enable the state to have a state-owned bank. Because, for example, let's say if government has 100,000 employees, if all of them are getting their salaries through the state, and if a service fee of $50 in a month is charged from them, that equally translates to what? 5 million. Let's say 2 million covers for administrator fees and all the salaries. 3 million is available to the government monthly, which is currently not there. So that money can be utilized to fund startup companies. It can be utilized by the government to buy stake into more companies and create parastatals. If you look at the classical example why whites were empowered in apartheid, is through parastatals. It was half partially owned state companies. That's how the apartheid system was empowering whites. And the apartheid system also built houses for the blacks because the state had ownership in almost every key means of production. Like they owned at least 50% in every means of production by that time.
Yeah. On the question is another topic that I'm very passionate about. You know, and I'm personally, this I'm going to say honestly, I'm worried about how easily foreigners can acquire land in Namibia. That does not translate to you and I when we go to China.
Yes.
You know, but it's very easy for people to have land, own land in Namibia. But we've got people that do not have land and people get dispossessed. We have people that were dispossessed in the past. They are currently landless. And yet people come here with their high currencies and acquire this land very easily. What does UDF say about that?
Look, that's a worrisome situation. And obviously, UDF will not prioritize foreigners owning land in Namibia while Namibians are landless. We first have to address the issue of landlessness of Namibians. Land which is available should first be allocated to Namibians, and the first priority must always go to Namibians. The only way how we can allocate land to a foreigner is probably, let's say, they are coming in to buy that land to set up a factory. That one, we know from there, we are going to generate revenue. It's going to help us with employment and things like that for investment purposes. But we cannot be prioritizing foreigners that are coming to buy residential land, coming to buy farms, and just to turn them into resorts and things like that. So we must prioritize allocation of land to Namibians first, local ownership first, because land is the only thing which goes along with your identity. You cannot say, I'm a Namibian, but you don't have land in Namibia. How are you a Namibian? So land, like if we say I'm a Damara, I must have land somewhere in the Damara land. So it must be like that.
Why is it a Damara example?
It's probably because I'm a Damara. That's why I took it. Because if I had said Namada, I would have said that UDF has already started lying even before elections.
Okay. Who's funding UDF?
UDF is only but funded
people
by...
People are very sensitive about their funding, you know, in terms of parties. But...
UDF is only funded by its members through membership subscription fees. And during elections, we rely on those that are in positions placed through UDF. For example, the regional councillors, local authority councillors, those people, they give donations in kind from the allowances that they get from local authorities and from their salaries that they get from regional councils and stuff. But we also just get state funding that we report to at ECN, because it comes, that state funding comes with the requirements on what it should be spent. So that one, it's not for campaign purposes and stuff. So we utilize it in the prescribed ways of how it should be used. And reports are always sent to ECN. So we just rely on donations from members and subscription fees on members in UDF. We don't have external donors. We don't have a foreign company investing in us with their dodgy agendas and stuff. So we just rely on our members, basically.
Okay. Now, especially this year, we have got many more independent candidates, and some other new parties are coming up. How does UDF view this? Are you guys concerned about this? What's your reaction to this?
My take on independent candidates is that, for example, let's say, for argument's sake, independent candidate wins. He becomes the leader of Namibian nation. Mind you, everything passes through the parliament, goes through national council.
Yes.
You have to choose your ministers only from parliament. Who are you going to choose as your minister? What are you going to do if this person sabotages your agenda? So it's a big question mark of, are they going to be able to unite all parties after they win? And it's going to be very interesting to see, are we having a national list that is going to accommodate everybody, or are they going to create divisions along tribal lines, or are they only going to benefit those parties that decided not to field the presidential candidates and throw their weight behind them? So it's going to be an interesting thing to see. But UDF is a party that believes in democracy. So we would not necessarily say that people deciding to stand as independent candidates is a wrong thing. But however, we do not allow...
But how concerned are you in terms of your votes that will now, that might now be split among these many newcomers?
It's really an area of concern, but we will never be... In a democracy, you can never regulate how the amount of contestants that you will find. Because it's everybody's democratic right to stand. So previously it was easy. People were only doing it through the party system. Like the party will field their candidate. But now any person who has got hopes and aspirations of becoming a president of this nation can just wake up tomorrow. Even yourself, Lolo, you can decide to be the president. And then you can just put up your poster and register. So it has become easy. But the only problem that I have with these independent candidates is sometimes some candidates are not quality candidates. They just decide, okay, since the party decided not to give me a chance, I would run independently. So it's sometimes an ego thing. And it's not really beneficial for the democracy of our country. Just like you were saying, it creates split votes that could have gone to other candidates that are having more of meaningful chances and realistic chances of becoming the president of this country. So in terms of that, if we must really have a sit down as opposition parties, because mainly it's opposition parties that are having independent candidates.
Tell me, man, you guys had a presidential debate in Vendo class?
Yeah.
What was it?
Yeah, it was a presidential debate, discussion, okay, where presidential candidates or their representatives could go and attend.
Okay,
yes.
The party now.
And to represent the
okay
party.
You know, if one looks at, as a layman now, normal Namibian, looking at the politics of Namibia, and especially on National Assembly level, UDF has always been present. But UDF has kind of been, or always been at the back seat in terms of, you know, robust conversations and leading conversations, serious debates, and so on. With the change in leadership and with new faces in parliament, are we going to see a change to that, or will you remain with the calm nature of UDF in parliament? What are we to expect?
Most definitely, UDF is going to, you are going to see more energy from us. It's not going to be business as usual, because these people that are in the current executive, majority of them are robust debaters. There are some colorful personalities there. So we look forward to be at the forefront of national issues. We don't want to shy away from national issues. We do not want to have that conservative approach anymore. We want to, if need be controversial, so that our people should get solutions to problems that they are facing. Because at the end of the day, we are representatives of the people, and we must represent the people in the best possible way. And that should be to engage robustly and to ensure that we just don't criticize, but we bring meaningful and practical solutions to problems that are faced, and through our debates and through our inputs that we are going to make in the National Assembly. So we are looking forward to the new session of parliament that is going to start, or the new parliament that will be sworn in like in March next year. So UDF is going to be at the forefront. Like, you will see a change. Like, when next maybe you have me again on this show, we'll discuss motions that we have tabled, or we'll discuss how UDF is performing. So we're already looking forward to that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, how balanced is the UDF leadership? Gender, in terms of ethnicity, and
In terms of gender, that's a very difficult thing for us to do in UDF, because it's a democratic process. Everybody just declares their aspirations. You are vetted by the electoral commission of the party, and if you meet the requirements, you get your chance to stand on the ballot. Mind you, currently we are in the executive, we only have one lady. But it's not that there were not female contestants at the Congress. Every portfolio, except the president portfolio, had a female. And majority of the delegates to the Congress were also females. But what the approach that takes the center stage in UDF is that let's vote according to capabilities. Let's vote on merit. We are a party that wants to grow. We are a party that wants to make an impactful contribution on the political landscape of Namibia. So let's not rather focus on wheelbarrowing and wheelchairing people based on gender and based on youth and stuff. But let's field our best possible candidates, so that when we cross the bridge and one day we become the ruling party, now we can say, but no, let's have that balance. Let's include the youth. Let's include the women. So me as a young person, I had to contest and to be elected by the electorate, because in UDF, we don't give anything on the silver platter. So, but we also have got people from Ongunda, those areas, the Hereros. They're also in the Central Committee. But unfortunately, the executive, we don't have other tribes in the executive. But it's not because other people did not contest. It's because we were not looking along lines of, let's, if all tribes that are present in UDF to be represented in the leadership structures, we were checking Solomlo, who is the best possible person for this job?
Yeah.
Let's vote that person in, because we want to transition, so we need the best currently.
Yeah.
So after we have built the UDF that all of us want to see, we can now come back and say, but no, guys, let's make it a 50-50 thing. Let's make it decent. So we cannot focus on those in as much as there's so in as much as there's an outcry of there must be more women, there must be more this and that, we had to look at our situation as UDF and we had to do what is best for UDF.
I see. Yes. No, that is very much understandable. I respect that, because we know that in the political spaces, people come up with color block, you know, leadership. But we know that there are certain agendas behind certain people in that leadership, and they are there to fulfill a role that has been planted there by virtue of the gender balance and you know, ethnic balance and so on. And then it's not a true representation of the merits.
Yes.
But so that's completely understandable. Okay. In terms of final remarks, man, I am enjoying the time here, but there are other things also that we have to attend to. In terms of your final remarks towards the voters now, you can even face that camera.
Okay.
Talk to the voters.
Fellow Namibians, I want to encourage all of you, first of all, to go and register to be eligible voters. Registration period starts from 3rd of June up until 1st of August. You can only make a meaningful contribution towards the change that we want to see if you are eligible voter. After you have done the first part of registering to be eligible voter, I would like to encourage all Namibians to go out in numbers and to vote for UDF, for equal representation, for a party that promises to implement the philosophy of social democracy, whether we are going to have a regulated capitalistic system where we'll use the revenue derived from all sectors by owning 50% state in all our means of production, and we are going to address problems that we face in the country by having a social welfare program that is workable and that is going to solve problems and that is practical and that is Namibian tailor-made to address Namibian problems. We are not here to say that we are going to promise you moon and the sky, but we are also on the ground and we are seeing your suffering. We are seeing that people come and make empty promises. But in terms of land, we are clear that we have articulated our standpoint that no Namibian should be without land. And we have given practical solutions as to how we are going to address the land question. We have also provided practical solutions on how we intend to get our fisheries and marine resources back in this country. We have also addressed issues where we said that retailing sector should not be dominated by foreigners, and it should be Namibians that should dominate that sector, so that every Namibian, we have proven, Namibians have proven that they have the ability to do the retail business. Those people that are selling cabana, those people that are selling tomatoes and things on the street, they have proven that they can also make a meaningful contribution towards the building of this economy. So all Namibians, UDF is the alternative that you have been waiting for all this time. We are here. Make sure that you go out in numbers and you vote for UDF. Thank you.
Great stuff, man.
Thanks.
Right. Just before we go, South Africans are voting today.
Yes.
And we are actually having this conversation while the same thing that we're talking about is happening across the border. What do you think is going to happen there, man?
I think there's a possibility for a coalition government.
You are saying the exact thing that I'm thinking.
Yes. There's a huge possibility for a coalition government.
Okay, why is that?
Because, look, ANC is not going to get outright majority.
Is it?
Yeah, because they have, look, all their strongholds. Free State. Mm-hmm. Makashule has taken Free State. KZN, mm-hmm. MK Suma has taken it. Mm-hmm. Malema has made inroads into all these areas. So he's going to steal votes. Mm-hmm. DA is obviously going to take Western Province. Mm-hmm. So where is ANC going to get their outright majority from? Mm-hmm. Where are they going to get it from? So I believe it's going to be MK, COPE, all the smaller parties that will align together. And I believe they will elect Malema as the president of South Africa, because their president is elected through the parliamentary system.
Malema will emerge victorious?
Yeah, he's not going to get outright majority in the election, but through a coalition, he is going to be the president of South Africa. So that's what I believe. Because, like, just looking at the dynamics of politics there, and Malema is basically Suma's prodigy. So in as much as they try to say that, no, this and that, just look at the birthday message that Zuma sent to Malema, saying that now you are 43, that's a good age to govern, knowing perfectly well that he will not be eligible to stand as the president of the country. So, like, if you read between the lines, and not just that, Malema is a capable young man who has got vision. He's a young man that is going to do wonders if given the opportunity. I think it's now time that we get rid of the liberation movements of Africa.
No, but are you seeing that the liberation movements are actually losing ground? You know, if you look at Namibia, you look at South Africa, Mozambique, Zimbabwe, you know, liberation movements are actually losing ground.
The problem is because, like, if you have to see, liberation movements only know one thing, and that is to liberate the country from oppression. They don't know anything about economic emancipation. After 34 years, can Swabo tell us that they will be able to economically emancipate Namibians? If they had all this time to do that, how would they be able to do it in five? Yeah, that's the thing. The same with ANC. So it's difficult if you are the one that is ruling at that particular time, because people are asking questions. Namibian nation, that's the thing. And the thing is, in the past, there was no access to internet and stuff. Yeah. People did not have comparative data to see that, like, you were supposed to do this and you were supposed to do that. The nation was not well informed in the past, but now we have got an informed nation. Now we have got a younger generation that is. The 70% of Namibian population is youth. So these people are always on social media. They are always watching YouTube. They're always reading. And they have now seen that our economic emancipation can only happen through the hands of somebody else, another party, apart from Swap. Thank you.
Mr. Narib, thank you so much, man.
Thank you, Mr. Lolo.
It was great having you in studio. And by the look of things, we might have you back here, where we just talk about, you know, politics in general.
Yes, sir.
And we can even go live. So, as promised, this was another episode with the UDF. And I encourage all the other parties that haven't yet responded to my requests, the Swapos of this world, the IPCs, come in. And let's hear from your side what the parties are coming here to, you know, to talk about, manifestos, plans, ideological directions, in terms of unemployment, how you're going to address these things and so on. So, yeah, looking forward to the next podcast with, I think LPM will be the next. Yeah, it's actually a great journey. Yeah, please follow me, like, subscribe, go on to our YouTube, Sankofa podcast, follow us on Instagram, although we're not so active on Instagram, TikTok we are, Facebook we are. Please follow these conversations and be informed.